We live in a very literal world, and we communicate with each other in lots of different ways. Most of our communication uses either written ideas or the spoken word. These are the most common ways that we communicate, but they're certainly not the only ones. Drawing diagrams is a very different form of communication. Diagrams have a very long history. They allow us to think in new ways and encourage us to approach problems differently. Even without practice, diagrams can be used to talk about complicated ideas and situations. Diagrams can be used to communicate ideas, but they're also useful for exploring areas we'd not normally be able to think about. Maybe it's because they're different, or maybe it's because we do different things with them, but diagrams certainly help us to understand things in fascinating new ways. The world is a very big place. The Mediterranean is a very complex and fascinating part of that world. Every year, from now until 2025, there'll be a 1.4% increase in population in the region. The population in the north is projected to grow to 68 million, in the south to 108 million. Urbanization is accelerating in the region. 200 kilometres a year are being built. Under such pressure, the people of the Mediterranean have choices to make. They need to figure out what's going on. I've been working in the region on a number of projects, all to do with sustainability. In this exercise, I'm using real data from an island in the north of the Mediterranean. People there drew me a rich picture. I've used this rich picture and reworked it with four diagram types to explore what is most important for them. In this picture, the main point is the question mark in the centre. What on earth am I trying to find out? Here's a farmer, and the farmer is thinking about fertile fields, wind turbines, things that work, a good dry stone wall around his farm to stop erosion. What's he? Is the reality? The reality is broken walls, dry ground, terrible climate. The farmer thinks he needs investment, so we draw this banker. This is a banker, and he's holding up money. And this is what the farmer needs, this investment of euro, so that he can plow this back into his farm, build his turbine, irrigate his fields, improve the dry stone walls. Hey, presto. Production has been poor in recent years, and you can see the timeline at the top there showing rest in peace as the crops diminish. The tourists keep on coming. They're playing in the sea. They're having fun. They're enjoying themselves. But there are issues about pollutants in the sea, and issues also that the sun gets a bit too bright and the wind gets a bit too strong, and these climatic changes are occurring all the time. The people I was working with really kept coming back to these dry stone walls, this issue of the fertility of the land and their own inability to learn the lessons needed to make this work. With education, with investment, they can increase production and they can make the agricultural sector thrive. The final part of the rich picture is a picture of a domestic dwelling with an outpouring of domestic water which is polluting the sea. This is an issue, the issue of sea hygiene, water hygiene most generally. The rich picture is all about community and all about the rural community and all about how that rural community is getting on with its life.
Here is another example of a rich picture. Rich pictures are a mix of drawing, pictures, symbols and text representing a situation from the point of view of the person or persons drawing them. The rich picture here is about a flood management. I drew this picture 15 minutes before the start of a conference on flooding where I was going to use rich picturing as a technique in my talk. Starting in the top right, you can see residential housing with solar panels and roofs under a major rainstorm. Behind, there is a power station heating up the atmosphere. Increased urban runoff into the drain systems, into the river has implications for groundwater levels, as less rain is available to soak into soils. But this could equally rise under intense storm situations leading to surface flooding. To the middle top of the picture, you can also see the role of London as a major finance centre, which exists as an island, but is also home to Lloyd's Insurance, a link to increased costs of changing weather patterns and flood insurance. To the top left, decision-making bodies such as local authorities are under pressure for meeting targets to approve development, perhaps leading to surface flooding. In the centre left, agricultural inputs into river systems are shown by the arrow from the fields going into the river. And on the far right-hand side, you can see a person on their computer trying to make sense of the complexity of the floods. Is this a 1 in 25-year flood, a 1 in 250, or a 1 in 1,000-year flood? Overall, the rich picture is quite structured, perhaps more than I would like it to be. It's almost like looking at a landscape with buildings, farmland, and a river running through it. However, I think the rich picture shows the different types of factors relating to flooding. And if I was to rework this, I think I would have liked to have made the flooding aspects more obvious by surrounding some buildings with floodwaters and perhaps showing flood defences being built. I might also add rainfall records and, of course, the importance of media.
In this spray diagram, I'm trying to catch some of that richness from the rich picture, but maybe start to structure it a little bit. Local community is the centre, and farming is the centre of that. Farming's been impoverished by years of underinvestment, and because of that impoverishment, the farming production is reduced, and the attractiveness of farming to the young community is also much reduced. Lack of investment, reduced fertility of the soil, soil erosion, and reduced crop yield are all major issues which afflict this farming community. The community itself knows that it's capable of much more, but there's a great need for investment and inputs which is going to make that community work well. So the second major arm of the spray diagram is the investment arm. Farming needs investment, but there are some questions about the investment criteria and policy. How do farmers get hold of the money to invest in their land? Okay, tourism is fine for now, and that's another major arm coming from our spray diagram, but what about the future? And there's a worry that maybe the stuff that's happening to the farming community might go more widely in future. Fishing, there's a reduced catch, and maybe there's also a link here to waste and waste production from domestic and industrial sites. The major components then of the spray diagram, farming, tourism, fishing, waste, they're capable of much more. They need more inputs. But the investment policy is questionable, maybe incomprehensible, maybe just hidden. And that has implications for the future.
Here is another example of a spray diagram. Spray diagrams show connections between related elements associated with a particular idea or issue. This is a spray diagram of some environmental concerns relating to mobile phones. Around the central topic of mobile phones, you can see six main themes: manufacturing, packaging, transport, use, infrastructure, and end of life. Following the manufacturing theme outwards, we can see some aspects relating to materials used in mobile phones. Metal mining being important, energy used, and location of manufacturing. Components may have come from different places and many different companies. If we follow the infrastructure theme, you can see a range of possible concerns, such as the data and computing systems which drive the phone networks. These have significant energy materials and transport implications. The diagram interprets environment fairly loosely and makes links to human health and also social considerations. Overall, the number of items in the diagram suggests there are quite a number of concerns relating to mobile phones, perhaps far more than we might think about if we just focused on use.
From the systems that I can see, there are a few standout points that I need to focus on. Clearly, my main focus is the local community. And within that local community, again and again and again, farming is critically important. Fishing is also important, and the production system arising from both of these is key. Investment has kind of again arisen again and again as I've talked to people, as I've worked my way through the case study, and tourism was also important. Weather has a major impact. Erosion is an output against beyond the local community's capacity, so it's outside the system, as is finance and banking, which are the great forces which drive that system. They sit in the environment of the system, but they're very important drivers of the system.
Here is another example of a systems map. A systems map is a snapshot of a situation at a moment in time from the perspective of the person drawing it. This systems map is based on research into UK river catchments. It shows the elements that might influence how a water catchment is managed and functions. Some of these elements are grouped together within seven subsystems. For example, the farming subsystem includes the farmer, advisors, traditions of farming, family security, economic returns. Together, these shape the kind of farming that is done in a catchment. The river managing subsystem includes elements such as water companies, residents, volunteers, non-governmental organisations. I drew this map several times before settling on the themes in the subsystems. I'm still not entirely happy with it though, as I think that the residents element is not sufficiently developed and seems to be more an afterthought. My next iteration would be to explore more fully how residents shape the way catchments are managed and function.
Working from the basis of the systems map, I can now start to think about where are the major influences within that map. Investment is where I start. Investment just about affects everything within my local community context. Farming, production, fishing and tourism. And of course, the external force there is banking. Weather has a huge impact too. So there's weather affecting the community, fishing, farming, erosion. But there's again this link now between farming and erosion, which I don't think was so clear to me before, but really has gained clarity now. Weather and finance and banking, these are the great forces that I'm up against, I think, as I start to consider the complexities of this context.
Here is another example of an influence diagram. An influence diagram represents the main structural features of a situation and the important influences that exist between them. The arrow shows the capacity to influence, but not a sequence of influences, unlike a multiple cause diagram. The influence diagram shown here is about the influences on food waste. You can see that the large portion size is a key influence on food waste. This arises from plentiful fast food, cheap food, mass manufacturing and restaurant practices. In the lower left of the diagram, you can also see that poor cooking skills can influence large portions and also directly lead to food waste. Poor skills is influenced by variable education, training, family apprenticeship, and cooking in the media, perhaps by overemphasizing the importance of gourmet-type food experiences rather than developing basic skills. Other factors influencing food waste include food dislikes, use-by dates, and so on. I like this diagram because it conveys all in one go the diverse influences upon food waste. Some of these could require further investigation. For example, what influences restaurant practices which lead to large portion sizes?
So far, I've gained a sense of a lot of complexity going on, and now I want to think about the causality behind that complexity. I'm starting off with investment as being my key element, the investment priorities which, if you like, fire up all the systems that I've been looking at. There's a lack of investment, so the priorities have led to some kind of lack of investment, and that has impacted and has a direct causality upon farming, which is in decline. The declining farming is also leading to a reduction in farming practice. And again in the context, people talk to me about dry stone walls. So this is a big emblem of this decline. The dry stone walls, take them away, you increase erosion. And you can see the first of the causal cycles there, working its way on the left-hand side of the diagram. Also coming out of farming decline, we have reduced production. And that's very much related to reduced investment and that overall lack of investment. So again, we have another causal cycle, two negative causal cycles leading to farming decline. That is becoming quite clear. The reduced production also means a decline in the rural landscape, and maybe that has impacts for the future on tourism. We don't know about that, but as the rural environment becomes less attractive, maybe tourism also reduces. Climate's a major causal force here. It affects weather, that impacts on erosion. It also means there are more storms, and we know that those storms have impacts on both the fishing production and also on tourism. So climate and investment really impact upon the present economic structure of the island, but also its long-term sustainability. You can see I've underlined at the end there, reduced production as being my main theme.
Here is another example of a multiple cause diagram. A multiple cause diagram is used to explore why an event or change occurs. Unlike influence diagrams, multiple cause diagrams can be read sequentially, backwards or forwards. This multiple cause diagram is about the decision to invest in domestic photovoltaic cells, shown here as PVC. This is the event or change we're trying to explain, and so we can read backwards from this. Two major causes lead to this decision. On the one hand, there is consideration of other investments that a person could make, for example, bank accounts, and on the other, interest in investing in PVC. These two primary causes can be seen to arise from a series of other causes. These are on the outer ring of the diagram: the increasing cost of power, reduced income, recession, personal frustration at the ability to do something about the global climate situation. These variously lead to effects of rising bills and a personal need for this person to be green. Add to the mix one further cause of a 25-year guarantee of income from PVC, and the map is complete. If you work from the outer and primary causes, you end up with a series or set of multiple causes for the final event. Conversely, if you work back from the final event, you can see how the causes acted upon each other. ¶¶